Hi folks, I know I don't usually start the video like this, but I have a surprise for you. I finally came up with a logo and stuff. I got a lot of special things and some extras to show you and some little explanation to go, but I'd like to welcome you to my guitar fell over. Oh no. PJC. Oh crap, it's backwards. I keep forgetting that this camera's backwards. Someone get me some better equipment. But the PJC, Music and Ministries, and the design
requires, what did I do with it?
A little bit of explanation. This is my rough draft. I was going to have it blue, and the reason, and I was going to have Mount Calvary, you know, where Jesus died, you know, on the J. Well, I got an actual picture of that mountain. Now, it doesn't have there is a spot on it that looks like a skull, but it's not in this picture, because all the pictures that I could find with that in it, I didn't like it. It didn't fit it. Because the problem I was having was coming up with a background. But blue, it's my initials, actually. But Peter is P is lowercase, and Jesus Christ is exalted. That's why it's like that, even though it's backwards to you, which I don't like. But that's all right. But we got an exciting program for you. And I hope, and this is kind of an audition tape. I'm going to do another rush run through after this to get a better time idea because of all this extra stuff I'm throwing here. But as it is an audition tape, I wanted to show you guys a couple things. And I don't really like to show my qualifications and my things I've done, but this is my diploma from the Maine Baptist Bible Institute and the Little program from my graduation. You really can't read that, can you? But basic Bible doctrines, history of the Bible, defense of King James, how to prepare a sermon and preach it and all that stuff. If you want to know more, let me know. But I was actually trained for a couple years as a preacher of sorts. And I still don't like how that is, but I guess it's as good as we're going to get that. And I'm coming to you from my living room. This is my TV's over there. And this is the school upgraded, one of the schools in town upgraded its smart screen. This is a smart screen. Whoops, see? I told you. Wasn't supposed to do that. There we go. Wasn't ready for that yet. But yeah, it's a smart screen, and it's got the projector, and I got the pens and everything, and I got the whole system. It's really cool. And they were, I remember when I worked for the school, they were literally throwing them in the dumpster. And I asked the head custodian, like, hey, can I take one of these homes? Like, sure, I don't care. We're throwing them away. I was like, cool. So there's an upgrade to this. There's no projector on those ones. Can you believe it? This is still like science fiction and brand new to me. I love it. And also, I got a live studio audience. Say hi, guys.
Hi, guys.
Hi.
You're funny. My wife and my son are out here right now. Since this fell over, let me just make sure it's... see? Hey, I'm glad I'm doing this. It did go out of tune. This was not planned. I'm still kind of constricted, but it's a lot of fun. I'm really excited. This is it's a patriotic gospel presentation, hence my shirt. I like these little, these are like one of them silky, kind of smooth shirts. I really like them. Today, there's gonna be one extra thing because I don't plan on having a projector or a screen for my gospel, my patriotic symbols, my symbols of freedom gospel presentation. So you're gonna get a few extra pictures, and stuff, and little extra what I hope is informative things than what the live audience will be getting if I ever get to do this. Like I said, this is kind of my audition tape for that. So to start. They say, good morning, everyone. Let's get started with this old familiar song, and I invite you all to sing along, especially the younger ones. You feel free to sing along, Jonathan. It won't bother me, but this is the only song you're going to get to sing along with, okay?
Okay.
Now, let's see. All right. All right. Let's see. You're a grand old flag. You're a high-flying flag. And forever in peace may you wait. Every heart beats true for the red, white, and blue, where there's never a false or right. white and blue, where there's never a boast or brag. And should all the acquaintance be forgot, keep your eye on the grand old flag. Keep your eye on the grand old flag. Just realized a couple of them chords aren't the right chords, and in the verses they're completely different in a couple spots. So, but today that's all I have for guitar music today. Believe it or not, you lucky folks. And that was a little awkward because I found out about 10 minutes before I started this that somehow my Bluetooth foot pedal for that got shut off. So, but anyways. But welcome, and hey there, everyone. Thank you so much for coming to this Symbols of Freedom Gospel presentation. My name is Peter Copeland. Most of you guys already know that. And many of you know me as the Anthem Guy. I have had the privilege and opportunity of performing our national anthem at several of our local sporting events, and I've even gotten to sing at some American Legion events. I should probably just bring this in front of me. It looks a lot better. And so I'm so excited to bring before you today a way that I think is going to be able to combine our faith and our patriotism. We're going to have a lot of fun, as well as grow in our faith. And this next song is a song I've loved for many years, but has taken on new meaning for me as I've gotten to live in a wonderful small town in the Midwest. I was, most of you know, but I lived on the East Coast in cities and stuff. The Midwest, while very familiar in some respects, was a complete culture shock in others. So, but as I've gotten to, you know, be a part of this wonderful small town and even been in a couple of our parades, the song is full of patriotic imagery and a heartwarming message. And so I hope you guys enjoy it. And I hope I can do it. I've been trying to condition my throat. But here we go. In a Midwestern town, children form a parade, with a flag bearer leading the way. As farmers and teachers, the old and the young, live together their voices to say, I pledge my allegiance to the grand old flag and the promise of hope from sea to sea. Under God, one nation, undivided we will stand. Lift the banner of liberty. It's the final kickoff for the NFL, and the stadium is packed with screaming fans. All the banners are flying, the colored guards dance. Like a wave, silence moves through the sand. I pledge my allegiance to the grand old flag and the promise of hope from sea to sea. Under God, one nation, undivided we will stand. Lift the banner of liberty. sunshine is hungry, where men have no homes, where the powerless are yearning to breathe free. May we fight for justice till there's justice for all. And because we got manners to be, I pledge my allegiance to the grand old flag and the promise of hope from sea to sea. Under God, one nation, and divinely will stand the banner of liberty. Crap, it's still dried out at the end of the song. Yeah, I got applause. Thank you. You're so kind. Oh, it says you're watching me.
I am watching
you. Oh, okay.
I'm making sure the video is going smoothly.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Yes, my production manager, ladies and gentlemen. I don't know, man, maybe it's just me. Maybe I'm not meant to sing these high notes and swelling themes, which I've always wanted to do. I've literally been working at this all my life, and I'm still not that good, but I try. Anyways, this next song, in that last song, I really like a lot of the parallels in that last song. It's almost like the Pledge of Allegiance set to music, and I think that last verse, bridge, or whatever you want to call it, is very powerful and meaningful one, and especially for me, it's kind of part of what motivated me to join the military. And my next song, is a lot, actually, I'm pretty sure a lot of people haven't even heard that song, but this next song is probably even less well-known, but it's written by a man named Tracy Dart, who many of you know a song he wrote called God on the Mountain. You know, the God on the mountain is still God in the valley. When things go wrong, he'll make them right. And the God of the good times is still God in the bad times. The God of the day is still God in the night. I love that song. I've done it a couple times in my videos, so maybe you've heard it. But I would ask you to keep his family in prayer, though. We recently lost both Mr. Tracy Dart. And he was old. I mean, it was his time. He was getting up there, but not before we lost his son. His son died first. His son, bear with me, his name was Stony Mountain Dart. I know it's a weird name. I respected it, though. I was like, hey, guys, you guys are off doing something I'm not doing. And I actually had the honor and privilege of meeting both of them. And anyways, but Mr. Dart wrote many, many gospel songs, including this one. And so I really hope you like it. What does it mean to a man to see a flag waving high? He thinks of his blessed homeland and the man who had to die to preserve him the right to believe what he wants to and say what he wants to say. That's what the flag means to me today. What does it mean to a man to see an old rugged cross? He thinks of the God who gave his son to die for the souls of the lost, that they have the right to love him and serve him and from sin be set free. That's what the cross means to someone like me. Thank God for the flag that gives me the right to worship the man on the cross. Long may it wave o'er the land of the brave. We pray that these rights won't be lost. Thank God for the cross that bore our Savior that day on Calvary. Thank God for the flag and the cross. Thank God for the flag and the cross. Thank God for the flag and the cross, for they gave me liberty. Thank God for the flag that gives me the right to worship the man on the cross. Long may it wave over the land of the brave. We pray that these rights won't be lost. Thank God for the cross that bore our Savior that day on Calvary. Thank God for the flag and the cross. Thank God for the flag and the cross. Thank God for the flag and the cross, for they gave me liberty. Thank God for the flag and the cross, for they gave me liberty. Now, this for this next one, I want to take just a moment because, well, I'll tell you what. Speak to you about something very close to my heart because I don't want you to misunderstand what the next song's about. Because when I first heard it many years ago, to be honest, as much as I love it now, the first time I heard it, a couple of the lyrics took me back. And I don't want anyone to be offended. And I don't want the experience to be ruined or the message to be lost. And there's a couple lines in the song that might make you feel like it's putting down the symbols of freedom for this country. And it's not. Like this last song I sang, I think did a better job of portraying it. But it simply holds the work of the cross in higher esteem. Because as great as a country is and as meaningful the symbols that stand for it are, the cross is greater. Jesus and his work on the cross is greater and more meaningful. And because so many people have contrasted, well, the soldier has died for your freedom and your physical well-being, Jesus died for your soul and your spiritual well-being. And the Bible says, what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world but loses his own soul? All the freedoms and all the prosperity in the world will mean nothing, absolutely nothing, if your soul is not redeemed. And that's all it's saying. So, to sum that up, the cross being greater does not diminish the flag, the Statue of Liberty, and what they stand for, nor does it diminish the sacrifices made for them. And please let us remember that the flag, the statue, and yes, even the cross are just symbols. I mean, the cross is a very easily recognized symbol, but isn't it curious that that is the symbol we have chosen to represent our faith and our religion? I don't know about you, but I'm sure that Jesus doesn't like to be reminded of that particular symbol. A lot of bad things happened on a hill far away. Alright? But all the same, I mean, it is about the work. It is about what he did there, not about that symbol. But it is not the cross that we worship, because that would be idolatry, to worship the object. But we do worship the man who gave his life on that object and the work he completed. So please, with all that in mind, with all that, I would ask you to please enjoy this next song. In New York Harbor stands a lady with a torch raised to the sky, and all who see her know she stands for liberty for you and me. I'm so proud to be called an American, to be named with the brave and the free. I will honor flag and a trust in God and the Statue of Liberty. Golgotha stood cross with my Lord raised to the sky, and all who kneel there live forever as all the saved can testify. I'm so glad to be called a Christian, to be named with the ransom and all of the Statue liberates the citizen. So the cross liberates the soul. Oh, the cross is my statue of liberty. It was there that my soul was set free. Unashamed, I'll proclaim that on the old rugged cross is my statue of liberty. Stop that before the next track plays. This is a great song. There's a lot of patriotic songs I've found that I'd love to sing, but they all are very challenging, and I probably didn't condition my throat the way I should have. I was trying, not for lack of trying, but I think I need to do more because I have done this. I have done these successfully. I just wish I could do it when it comes to performance time. But I work full-time. So if there's any sponsors out there, so I can sing full-time, that'd be great. No, anyway, this next part is... Anyways, sorry. Now, what a great message is in that song, though. You know, this next part I think you enjoy. I'm going to try to bring a deeper meaning to our and understanding to our national anthem. But first I'm going to try to give you a few interesting factoids. Some of you might already know this information, but some of you guys, especially the younger crowd, might not. Did you know that the song we know as our national anthem is really only the first verse of the Star-Spangled Banner? To be honest, I actually refer to them as two different songs, because our national anthem is just the first verse, and the Star-Spangled Banner is the whole thing. And I found this information out, in a hymnal called the All-American Church Hymnal, and I'll show it to you guys some other time, but I actually got it, when I made up these notes, I was studying from it, but in a lot of hymnals, there's only two verses, but there's four, at least, you know, there might be more, I don't think there is, but there might be more, and in a little bit, I'd like to break down some of the phrases in older languages that was used in the song. But first, I'd like to share a few little factoids I learned. As most of you know, Francis Scott Key first wrote the Star-Spangled Banner in September of 1814 during the War of 1812. I didn't realize that war lasted so long. with England. This is where England tried to recapture American colonies after losing the Revolutionary War. But I actually learned something new while researching for this. I was always taught or always believed, for some reason, Mr. Key was a prisoner on board a British ship during the bombardment. He was not. Mr. Key was not held on a British ship during the bombardment of Baltimore and Fort McHenry. He was actually on board an American true ship, which was not a military ship. It was unarmed. And he was there for negotiations, actually, but we'll get to that in a minute. And he glimpsed the devastation through a spyglass, like a small telescope for you younger guys. He was a lawyer by profession and was sent with another lawyer named John S. Skinner. They had been sent for some urgent negotiations, so while not captured by the enemy, he was certainly helpless to watch as the battle unfolded. On a military ship, so he wasn't even engaged in the battle. And the song actually tells a whole story of what he saw that night. So I'd like you to listen to what Mr. Key had to say about those events that unfolded that evening and into the early morning. Remember, these things happened overnight. And for my viewers, I got something special for you. This is the flag. This is the flag that inspired the song. This is a modern recreation of it that currently flies over Fort McHenry. And I'm in a minute. Isn't that cool? I like that. This is a view of the bombardment. Before they had reporters and stuff, they didn't have cameras, so they just... But you can see my laser probably isn't going to even show up on the... It doesn't. But you can see the cannon fire and everything. This is just Fort McHenry. This is just kind of what it... This shape right here, you're actually going to see... And next slide is a... That's what it looks like. And you can see the flag there. Is that modern day depiction of the original. Isn't that pretty cool? I love that. And those are some of the cannons that are in the song. At least I'm pretty sure the original cannons. I'm not a historian. That'd be cool though. Yeah, and back to that. And actually this little thing, I didn't really explain it on the... This little check mark, it's like an underlying thing I like to do when I would sign my name, in case I was ever famous one day, you know. Okay, that's lame. But no, that's what that is. I thought it was a nice little accent for it, too. But anyways, remember, this happened overnight, and there's four verses. I'm going to try to get to them relatively quickly. Now, the first line here is a question. And while other questions are asked in the song, most of them are right here in the first verse. Okay? So here we go with our first line and question. Oh, say can you see, by the dawn's early light, what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming. Oh, can't you see, the sun's coming up. The image, or this thing that we saw, last night when the light was fading, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight. That's only the first half of the question, but I think it's pretty obvious that the bright stripes and stars that were on the flag through this fight, which put them in jeopardy, and the second half, or the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming. Over the wall, that's what a rampart is, you young guys. It's a wall. It's a barrier. Over the walls as we watched, as it was streaming in the last glimpses of twilight, and where they punch it, and the rocket's red glare, those bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Rockets, or something like them, something a lot like a firework, but instead of decoration or a display, it was intended to harm, you know, it was a weapon. It was intended to blow up and blow stuff up. But then the cannonballs exploded, you know. So we could see by the light of those explosions and the fires that our flag was somehow, miraculously, still standing through the onslaught. And this last line, of course, is the last question. Oh, say, can you see? Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave? They see all four verses end in a similar manner, but that's the only one that poses a question. So I guess the thing to take away from that last line is that he's asking you a question. Does not this flag still wave triumphantly and majestically over the land of the free and the home of the brave? We move on to the second verse. On the shore dimly seen, through the mist of the deep, where the foe's haughty host in dread silence reposes. Can't you see in the dimly lit darkness that through fogs and mist, the enemy's arrogant host, which that's what haughty means, just a fancy word, or haughty is arrogant, and a fancy word for crowd, or group, or force, like a force of people is host, the host of, the hosts of heaven, you know, the soldiers of heaven, the crowd, the group, in dread silence, you know, you see that there's a heavy feeling of dread that night. And reposes, I had to look that one up. I didn't know what that meant offhand. My vocabulary isn't very good, apparently. But it just means to reposition themselves. So, when the foe's haughty host, in dread silence, where they're quietly regrouping. And it's dreadful. And then, next line. What is that which the breeze, or the towering steep, as it fitfully blows, half conceals, half discloses? The breeze is blowing hard over the high walls and the high hills, and it half hides and half reveals. That's what discloses. Discloses means it shows. It reveals something. And reveals what's going on over there. Now it catches the gleam of the morning first beam, in full glory reflected, now shines on the stream. Once again, we are reminded that it is early morning when these thoughts are coming to Mr. Key. As the first rays of sunlight hit the water, that's what it means, shines on the stream. So the first rays of sunlight hit the water, we see it. I love it. This is very poetic. And now, the end, where he emphatically tells us what it is he just saw. 'Tis the star-spangled banner. Oh, long may it wave. O'er the land of the free and the home of the brave. He's saying, oh, there is our flag. It is the symbol of our freedom and our hope. Now, on to the third verse. Now, this one requires, a larger chunk to quote, and then we'll try to break it down in smaller pieces. Because it's a much bigger statement he's making here. And where is the band who so vauntingly swore that the havoc of war and the battle's confusion, a home and country, should leave us no more? So we're going to take them one at a time right now and say, where is that band? You know, a group, a gang, most likely the soldiers. Who so vauntingly swore, they were bragging, vaunt, I looked that one up too. Vaunt means to brag. So vauntingly means they were braggingly. They were boasting. And I think this next part, we're going to need two lines. That the havoc of war and the battle's confusion, a home and country should leave us no more. War is chaos. It is destruction. And battle is very confusing. Ask any combat vet who's ever been in battle how hard it is to keep your thoughts in order on the battlefield. And you see, we haven't had to face that particular problem here. Because we've been fortunate enough not to have a war on American soil in recent history. But the phrase, home and country should leave us no more, I think is saying that our home won't be violated anymore. And our country won't be threatened with destruction. It won't have to leave us by a threat of invasion as long as we win. And the next line, their blood washed out their foul footsteps' pollution. Once again, talking about the enemy here, saying there is no reason for them to come here and try to recapture something they've lost. The blood of the enemy was washing out their own foulness in the path of destruction they took, footsteps' path, you know. No, and next line, no refuge could save the hiring and slave from the terror of flight nor the gloom of the grave. This battle was so intense that the hired help and, yes, slaves. It was always wrong to own slaves. I want to interject. It's always wrong. But it is something that happened. And you can argue all day about the details, but it is something that happened. But even they could not hide from the absolute terror of the battle or even death. But however, if you recall from the previous two verses that the early morning light, they could see the star-spangled banner in triumph doth wave or the land of the free and the home of the brave. And now the fourth, final verse. Oh, thus be it, whenever where free men shall stand between their loved homes and the war's desolation. From now on, wherever free people stand in the way of those who seek to destroy us and leave us empty, because that's what desolation, it's emptiness. That they might be... I think I forgot to finish my thought there. in my own script here. But yeah, when free men are standing, people are standing between us, our homes, and the desolation of war. I guess it's kind of self-explanatory. That they might be, next line, blessed with victory and peace. That speaks for itself, so we go on. May the heaven-rescued land praise the power that has made and preserved us a nation. His faith, I think, really comes out in this one, and that while the honorable men of our armed forces were the ones laying down their life, it was God who was giving the increase. And I should have typed those out. I'll have to see. This is only a rough draft. I'm glad I'm doing this. But it was God who sprung giving the increase. It was God who was spurring them on to victory. scripture references here, like it says in Psalms 21:31 and 1 Corinthians 3:6. I think it, Psalms is where the horse is prepared against a day of battle, but it, victory is of the Lord. And 1 Corinthians 3:6 is where Paul is talking about how he spread the word of God. He planted, Apollos watered in prayer and discipleship, but God gave the increase. God reaps the harvest. We can plant, we can sow, we can water, we can give him sunlight, but God is ultimately the source of life. And he was the ultimate source of success. And before I read this next part, I'd like you to know that in this case, the word conquer just means to conquer the enemy. Not territory, not, you know, that's not what the war was about. It was just about conquering our fears and sending the enemy back where they came from. So then, conquer we must when our cause is just. And this be our motto, in God is our trust, and the strong finish, and the star-spangled banner, in triumph shall wave, or the land of the free, and the home of the brave. Pause for effect. Sorry. Thank you. Thank you so much. I do hope we've all learned something today and that maybe we have a new appreciation for what was just an old song should now tell a story. And maybe even open our eyes and our hearts to what battle might be about. And it's amazing what one little song can do when you understand it. And yes, sometimes with older songs, we have to look up some information or words that just aren't used anymore. But then, you know, sometimes I think that was intentional. Why should we understand all these things? Easier to control us. But once again, the Bible coming in with the answer says, a workman need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. I mean, really, just mean study for yourself. Looking things up is a good thing to do. You can't have everything handed to you. I mean, that whether you're a Christian or not, that's something a lot of people can agree with. You everything handed to you, you get lethargic, lazy. You get... can't think of the word now. You just expect it. You get spoiled. It's not okay. It's not good for you. Everyone that treats hard work as a negative thing. It's really a great thing. It's good for you. And with that, I hopefully some new appreciation. And I'm going to skip it for this video, but I would invite people to join me as we stand, respect the flag, and just the first verse of the Star Spangled Banner, our national anthem, and I'd sing it. But I will go with my closing. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, for joining me today and sitting and watching all of this. I hope it was edifying, uplifting, and enjoyable for you. Now, please, let's kind of have a word of prayer, and that'll conclude my presentation and the video for today. Lord, thank you that I have the time to do this, and thank you for the ambition. God, I do selfishly ask a bit that you help me be better at it, and help me to do a better job. I want to reach people, I want to help people, and I hope that with all the negativity around, that people see our country is not our government. Even patriotic people who are Bible-believing really don't like our government. They're not doing anything to help us. So God, please help us remember we're in this together, to be upset about the bad and celebrate the good. Thank you for all you've done, not the least of which, well, really the most important and best of which was sending your son for us. Help us to rightly divide the word of truth and help people to be receptive to it. All we can do is tell people. We need to do so in love and compassion. I ask you to help us do that. In Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen. Thank you for joining me. Please tune back next time. And I hope to see you then. Thanks. Bye.